think. Just think.
Think of an ancient civilization. Perhaps the closest thing that humanity has ever seen to paradise. Yet perhaps the closest thing humanity has ever seen to hell.
Think. Oh, shut up. This is about the Aztecs, not Lord of the Rings.
Well, thanks for spoiling it. Buddy's right. We're going to be looking at the ups and downs, ins and outs, and the things you didn't need or even want to know. Warning, things can get pretty gory.
So join us as we take a deep dive into the Aztecs.
Both Cambridge and Oxford universities were around before the start of this empire. You would know that anyway, because our viewers, of course, all go to Oxbridge. Obviously.
The empire existed from 1345 to 1521 CE. Folks like Leonardo da Vinci and Richard III were still hanging about back then. Just think of the YouTube crossover potential.
I think that's enough thinking for one day. So let's get into hardcore facts. In terms of size, the empire was not exactly giant, but still very much the dominant force in the Mesoamerica area. At its near dusk, the Aztec Empire is presumed to have had a population of 5 to 6 million people across 80,000 square miles. And at its center, the great city of Tenochtitlan.
The Aztec people originated from a nearby island. We don't quite know where it was located, or even if it was actually real, but it is assumed that it was in the southwest of USA / northwest of Mexico in today's world. The Aztecs' most important god, Huitzilopochtli, commanded them to leave this island and partake on a journey to a promised land. A fertile land full of good weather. It would be an epic, centuries-long odyssey which would take them to vastly different places based on how priests at the time interpreted this holy message. They were looking for this promised land for so long, but they would never find it. Not until Tenochtitlan.
Look for a rock with a cactus on top. Those are Huitzilopochtli's guiding words, sending the Aztecs finally to their promised land. It would be called Tenochtitlan, literally meaning the place of the cactus on the rock. The Aztec people would build an epic city with a strong base. The empire would begin, expand, and thrive. Tenochtitlan was built over two islands situated on Lake Texico. It forms the base of the modern-day Mexico City, which is a huge city in and of itself. But Tenochtitlan was special, perhaps magical. It was a major megacity like Paris and New York. Perhaps not the multicultural hub of the aforementioned modern cities, but it had huge wealth and was home to groundbreaking technology. It was also the center of the Aztecs' business, politics, and religion. World-class hydraulic and transportation systems, which the world had rarely, if not ever, seen before. Causeways, canals, dikes. While London was stuck with highly polluted Thames water, the Aztecs had clean water, implementing aqueducts to carry water from springs. There were great temples that not even the epicest pro-Minecraft gamer could build. 600 odd years ago, Tenochtitlan was the place to be.
The Aztecs did not always thrive. At the start, there were many battles with neighboring civilizations. In fact, at the very beginning, the Aztecs were merely a vassal state to the larger, more powerful, overlord, Azcapotzalco state. In 1375, Acamapictli became the first Tlatoani. The Aztecs picked him based on a set of criteria where, naturally, military skill was of utmost importance. Acamapictli was largely responsible for the great rise of Tenochtitlan, turning it from a town into a major city. Fascinatingly enough, Acamapictli let the people decide his successor, voting on one of his seven sons.
The Aztecs gradually grew in influence and even made the Azcapotzalco Council begin questioning who was really the master. The Aztecs demanded the lowering of their own taxes, as well as demanding aqueducts, and they also began to take land. They formed an alliance with Texcoco and Tlacopan, which were other cities in the Azcapotzalco Empire, and together they began conquering land. They would be known together as the Triple Alliance. No, not you. Not long after, the Triple Alliance marched into the Azcapotzalco capital and won an epic battle. They had finally gained independence, and Azcapotzalco was over.
But it was not until Itzcoatl, the fourth Tlatoani, that the Aztec Empire was properly born. The empire rapidly grew and soon became huger than the Azcapotzalco ever was. They took control of vast plains of land across Mesoamerica, controlling many different people of varying cultures and beliefs. Though it was still commonly known as the Triple Alliance, no, not you again, both Tezcuco and Tlacopan had pretty insignificant amounts of land. It was very much the Aztecs and the other two guys who I can't pronounce empire. All was happy until the Spanish arrived.
Nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition!
Well, it wasn't primarily an Inquisition. More of a colonial quest for land and bounty. But they did indeed plan a mass conversion into Catholicism. The Spanish conquistadors arrived in Aztec shores back in 1519, led by the famous Hernan Cortes, a fearsome and successful commander and a key figure in the growth of the Spanish Empire. The initial relationships were relatively peaceful. That is, until the Spanish made a pro-gamer move and took the Aztec Emperor Moctezuma hostage. Hostility grew exponentially, and Tenochtitlan was even more bloody than usual. Rocks pelted from rooftops, arsonism in Spanish quarters, mass human sacrifice. Oh wait, that one was normal. It was a 2-year-long epic campaign, great victories and betrayals. Remember good old Tezcuco? Yeah, well they, and many other traitors, made crucial alliances with Cortes and the Spaniards.
Top 10 animal betrayals, am I right?
On the 13th of August, 1521, Spanish and allied forces stormed in and captured the Aztec capital. Tenochtitlan had fallen. The Aztec Empire was gone.
Wow, that was really deep and sad, and I think I'm gonna cry. But what was life actually like for these Aztecs? Well, to start, they had a complex polytheistic religion. Huitzilopochtli was the main god, almost like a Zeus or Odin figure. He was a sun god, and because of him, thousands of Aztec lives were taken. For reasons.
Yeah, one day he just told the Aztec people to make human sacrifices or the sun wouldn't even rise. Yeah, sounds like a tough deal to me, but the Aztecs obliged, whether out of fear, belief, or both. The victim would have his innocent body placed upon a sacrificial stone in the temple. The priest would gouge out the poor soul's heart with either a Minecraft flint or obsidian blade. It's estimated that roughly 20,000 of these sacrifices took place each year.
There were many, many, many more deities, and they weren't much better. Like Tlaloc, the god of rain and storms, who demanded sacrifice of newborn children.
Although the Aztec Empire was a diverse nation, the main language was Nahuatl, from the Uto-Aztecan language family. It's been around even before the 7th century, and is still surviving nowadays, with about 1.7 million speakers today. It's not really that similar to any of the world's major languages today, but it has certainly had a noticeable impact on Spanish. Some English words coming from Nahuatl include
in terms of the Aztecs' contribution to modern-day Mexico, let's just say the Mexicans have a lot to be proud and grateful for. Mexico City was built upon the strong foundation of Tenochtitlan. Aztec ruins have massively contributed to Mexican tourism, and therefore the economy, and the world of Mexico itself derives from the Aztecs. That's not just Mexico, but the whole world. I mean, how would Trump survive without the word Mexico?
Mexico!
And that's not all we should say Tlazulcomati for.
Food. Usually, I'm not too happy about my job as the Fusion Maps resident connoisseur. But on the menu today is chocolate and popcorn? Nice. The main diet was that of maize. Boring. But when you dive into the snack department, things get insane. The Aztecs were believed to have taken the idea of chocolate from other Mesoamerican people, such as the Olmecs and Mayans. But the Aztecs took the admiration of chocolate to the next level and eventually brought it to the international stage. They actually drank chocolate. It was basically hot chocolate, but it could be made warm or cold, spiced or bitter. They were even thought to have smoked chocolate. The cocoa itself was mostly reserved for the upper class, and it held much value, even more than gold, so much so that it was used as a currency. Plus, some scholars say the Aztecs discovered popcorn. What would be the point of cinemas without this vital Aztec invention? Oh yeah, and sometimes they resorted to cannibalism as a source of protein, but we'll just skip over that.
So unless you're allergic to chocolate, a pacifist, or about to be eaten or sacrificed, you've got to love the Aztecs. Come to think about it, that's a lot of people. Anyway, thanks for watching.